Hi, welcome back to McClutchy Maths. My name is Natalie McClutchy, and today we're going to be talking about geometric sequences and reducing balance depreciation. And this is part of our geometric sequences series, which is the back half of our sequence series. And this is aimed at students in grade year 11 and 12 in maths methods, general maths, and maths applications. And in this particular video, you're going to find out how to model depreciation using a table, how to do it in a recurrence relation, in a rule, and also we'll talk quickly about what's coming up in the next couple of videos. So let's kick off and I'll introduce you to the concept of reducing balance depreciation. But first, let's flip back to our previous knowledge about sequences. We looked at depreciation in the context of an arithmetic sequence, which is a situation where we have the same fixed dollar amount is taken away from an asset's value every year. Now that, when we modeled it, forms in a graph a nice straight line of decline. And that's called the straight line method because of the way it looks when it's graphed. In this particular situation, we have what's called the reducing balance method. So you'll see depreciation called different things. And in this particular case, it's one that follows a geometric sequence. And what it means is that the value of the asset is going to depreciate by a fixed percentage. So that means that instead of a fixed dollar amount, like reducing by $5,000 a year, it might reduce by 2% per year. Now, it's not per 2% of the starting balance. It's actually 2% of the previous year's balance. So because that balance is declining over time, then the amount of depreciation will also decline over time. This will make more sense when you see it in a table, which we're going to look at right now. So we've got a company car purchased for $35,000, depreciating by 10% per annum, and we want to model that in a table, just the first 4 years. So firstly, let's start with a little table. We've got age, the value at the start, the depreciation, and the value at the end of the asset. So at time zero, we call that V0, that's our starting amount, our purchase price. That's our value at the beginning, and we're going to calculate 10% of that. I think you can probably do that in your head, hopefully, which is $3,500. And we take that away from the value at the beginning, and at the end of the first year, our value is $31,500. Now that value is going to carry forward to the next year and become our value at the beginning of V1. Now you might think, well, hang on a minute, I've got one row and it's called V0. Don't worry about the labels too much. That age is actually the amount at time zero or at the beginning of the year. So obviously at the beginning of the year, its age is zero, but at the end of the year, it's aged a year. So it's now aged year one and that drops down to the next row. Then we calculate 10% of that new balance and we reduce the new balance by $3,150 and we get a new balance at the end of the second year, which becomes our balance at the beginning of the third year. And so then we take 10% of that balance, we get $2,835 as our depreciation, take that away again from that new balance, and we get a value at the end of that third year, which becomes our time three for the beginning of the fourth year, $25,515. Take 10% of that, take it away, and you get at the end of the fourth year a value of $22,963.50. So you can see that column that says age is more referring to the time at the beginning of the year. And we've got four rows here, four amounts of depreciation. So that's 4 years worth of depreciation. Next part of this question asks us to calculate how much depreciated from the value of this asset over 4 years. So simply we need to add that depreciation column, all those numbers up. Four numbers added together will give us $12,036.15 worth of depreciation. Okay, let's talk about what that might look like if we were to graph it. So I've actually extrapolated out that same different situation with this company car for the next 6 more years. And I did this in Excel and I've graphed it in Excel as well. Here's what it looks like. Now you would notice that there's a slight curve to this. It's not a very steep curve because it's only 10% per annum. And what's actually happening here is that the value of the asset reduces by a lot more in the early years than it does in the later years. So we can see what that looks like. So if you're going to be graphing reducing balance depreciation, it's very important to note that that is actually a curve and not a straight line. So that means that you're going to have to freehand. You're going to have to put your different points in first and then sketch between. Don't use a ruler to join the dots with little straight lines in between. Freehand that with a nice smooth sketch. Be very careful not to rub backwards and forwards in between the lines, otherwise it looks very imprecise and messy. So it needs to be fairly neat, smooth, straight curve. Okay, the next part of our question wants to find out when this series is going to get its car value below $1. So we started at $35,000. How long is it going to take for the car to reach below a dollar? Now, it's kind of hard to see it on this particular graph because the scale on the y-axis is about a centimeter and we've got $5,000 happening in there. So you can imagine $1 is a teeny tiny millimeter, or not even a millimeter, of that particular section. So if you look at this graph, it looks like it's hitting below a dollar around the 45th year. It's not actually the case. When I modeled this in Excel, it actually fell below a dollar in the 99th year. And this is something really important to note with geometric sequences when you graph them, and also with reducing balance depreciation, is that it will never actually reach zero. In fact, it would take 143 years to even fall below 1 cent. And this is because we're always taking 10% off an amount, and 10% of something gives you something else. It might be a very small something, but it's definitely not zero. Something else that's important to note with a reducing balance graph is that we've got most of our decline, and it takes place in our first few years. You can see the gradient or the slope of that particular line is very steep in the initial times, and then as time goes by, that decline starts to slow down. So typically, a company might use this kind of method of depreciation if they're wanting to write the car off fairly quickly, because it's going to lose at least half of its value very quickly in its life. So these are the kind of cars that might get a lot of kilometers on them, or that the company wants to turn them over fairly quickly and get new vehicles on a regular basis. Okay, let's quickly talk now about a recurrence relation. You'd recall from previous videos that recurrence relations have three parts. So firstly, you've got your purchase price. That's your amount at time zero, and we call that V0 for value of zero. We've got our second part, which is our depreciation rate. Now, this is important. So our depreciation is calculated as 1 minus the interest rate, or the depreciation rate, as a decimal number, and that's why it's divided by 100. So if you're told it's 3%, it's not 1 minus 3 in brackets, it's 1 minus 0.03. So you need to change it into a decimal first. Now, the reason why it's subtraction is because this is a model of decline. It's reducing by an amount every year. If I had 1 plus, I'd actually be increasing the asset's value. It would be a model of appreciation or a growth model. And we don't see that with depreciation because the asset's losing value. The next part is our value after a certain number of periods of depreciation, and that will give us our value N plus 1. Let's look at how a recurrence relation might look with another worked example. A truck being purchased for $182,000, depreciating by 25% per annum. We're going to express that as a recurrence relation. So let's bring our basic form back. This is the one you need to memorize off by heart. And simply we're going to substitute in the information that we're given. A is going to be equal to $182,000. Our rate is going to be 25 over 100. And we could actually simplify that to 0.25. And then 1 take away 0.25 would be 0.75. Now, I do see a lot of people in exams, they leave the information in brackets and they don't actually simplify that when they're asked to give a recurrence relation. This may actually cost you marks if you're in an exam. So do make sure that you know how to do 1 take away 25 over 100 and changing it into a decimal, taking it away from 1 and simplifying that to simply 0.75. Okay, that was the first part of worked example 2A. 2B wants us to find the next three terms. So we're simply going to start from 182,000 as V0. We're going to find V1. So that's going to be 182,000 times 0.75, and that will give us the answer of 136,500. And then V2, we take that previous value of 136,500 times that by 75%. We're reducing that by 25%. And then our third and final term is $76,781.25. Okay, let's talk about our general rule for depreciation. This looks really similar to the compound interest rule on your formula sheet. In fact, all that's been changed here is instead of A as your amount at the end, you've got your value N, and instead of P, your principal, you've got V0, which is your amount at the beginning, and you've still got that power N on the end. That hasn't changed. Inside the brackets though, it's 1 minus 1 instead of 1 plus 1. So 1 plus I. So that's something really important to remember. You can actually adapt your compound interest rule and apply that to reducing balance depreciation. All you really need to change to use the same rule is just change that plus into a subtraction. So let's have a look at how that would work in this situation. The limousine purchased for $98,500, depreciating by 13% per annum. We're going to find the value after 10 years. So you could simply take your compound interest formula off your formula sheet, remembering that compound interest is a method of growth or appreciation in a geometric sequence, whereas we want depreciation, so we're going to subtract. Now we've just got to simply substitute our information in. Our value at time zero is 98,500. We're going to do 1 minus 0.3. I've already taken the 13% and changed that into a decimal there, and my power is 10. And then I'm simply going to evaluate what's in the brackets first, as following my bid mass rules. Then I do indices, so 0.87 to the power of 10, and then I multiply that by 98,500. And I get a value at the end of 10 years of $24,469.71. And of course, I'm going to write that in a statement because V10 wasn't asked for in the question. So I'm going to write a statement for that at the end. Okay, let's look at part B of this question. In what year will the limousine be scrapped? So scrapped is typically when it hits a value of zero. But in this situation, as we know, geometric sequences will never reach zero. So we're told that in this situation, the scrap value will be $15,000. So that's going to be our value at time Vn. So let's substitute that information into the question. And we're going to simplify that a little bit further. We're dividing both sides here by 98,500. And we've also simplified what's in brackets. 1 minus 0.13 is 0.87. We can try using the iterative function on our calculator. So let's get our calculators ready. Okay, so here we are with our calculator. What we want to do is raise 0.87 to a power a number of times until it hits 0.152284. So let's type into our calculator the number 0.87 and press the equal sign. Now what I want to do is multiply that by 0.87, because that's basically multiplying it by itself is squaring it. So if I press the equals button, I've now squared it. If I press my equals button again, I've raised it to the power of 3, to the power of 4, to the power of 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, got to be careful here now, 10, haven't quite fallen below 0.152284 yet, 11, 12, 13, and 14 takes me below. So it will be scrapped in the 14th year. So I'm going to basically write down a statement, and I would say it would reach its scrap value during the 13th year, but I would be writing that off at the end of that year. So that means at N equals 14 is when I'd be writing that off. Now, if I wanted to show my working for this, I would actually say using the iterative function on the calculator, and then I would write down every third or fourth day since it's only up to 14. So maybe the third year, the sixth year, ninth year, 12th year, 13th year, 14th year. And that would be the way to show that you've done all the work for that. The second method that we're going to use is using logarithms, and this is for our methods students in grade 11. So you'd remember with your log laws that N gets brought down in front of the number 0.87 when we apply a log of base 10 to both sides of the equation. So if we simply now divide both sides by log of 0.87, we're going to get N equals 13.514, and you can do this on your calculator fairly easily. Okay, so I'm going to show you how to actually put this onto your calculator if you're using a Casio. So we're dividing log 0.152284 by log 0.87. Now, we've got a fairly imprecise number here. There actually is some dot, dot, dots going up there. So let's make sure we've got a really precise answer here first. I'm going to take 15,000 and divide that by 98,500. And I get an answer here, which goes on into infinity. And I'm going to take the log of my answer and press equals. and that gives me negative 0.817. And then I'm going to divide that answer by the log. I'm going to put this in brackets just to make sure that my calculator uses the order of operations properly of 0.87, closing the brackets and press equals, and voila, I'll get 13.514 and so on. Now, because n is 13.5, we don't actually write off in the middle of the year. We're going to write that off at the end of the year as well. That would be n equals 14, or the 14th year. So we can also do that using logarithms. That's quite nice and a little bit more precise than using the iterative function on the calculator. Now let's have a quick look at what's coming up next on McClatchy Maths. So firstly, we are going to look at growth and decay situations for geometric sequences. Then I'm going to bring out some of geometric sequences for our methods students and finish off the series with some complex problems from past exams. I hope you've really been enjoying this series and it's been really helping you a great deal. And I'd like to welcome all of our new subscribers. Thank you so much for joining the channel here. We are almost up to 1,000 subscribers and it'd be wonderful to see you join. So please like and subscribe, and why not also follow us on Facebook for more tips, tricks and ways to get in contact with us, particularly through Facebook Messenger, and also on email if you have any particular questions. That's the best way to get a quick answer. So once again, I'd like to say thank you so much for joining me here. I'm Natalie McClatchy. Have a wonderful day.